That was Kevin visiting from New York, and thank you so much for bringing your violin with you. Really enjoyed that. Well, we are glad that you are here today. You made it, and we are going to worship together, and I invite us to stand for our call to worship this morning. It is time to worship. We thank God for providing in ways more than we can ask or imagine.
It is time to worship. We praise God for the privilege of gathering with a song in our hearts. It is time to worship. We seek to honor God through our responses and our gifts today. Let us worship God.
that you would speak to us, guide us. I pray that we would learn from your word this morning, that you would challenge our hearts. Lord, we give ourselves to you in this time and this moment to glory in your presence. Thank you and amen. We thank you that we have you and that you are present in our lives and in our world, and that you will be there to the end of the world, and that you are making all things new in our hearts and in our lives. Amen. You may be seated. We are going to have the children come forward at this time. Cindy Sweet.
Good morning, everyone.
Morning, Cindy.
So, this is a special day for us. This is my last Sunday with you all, and it's heartbreaking, indeed. And it's been a crazy week, and God is good. So I just wanted to share just the things from my heart. First, just gratitude for being here and for Pastor Dave believing in me and listening to the Holy Spirit and saying, I want you to come be with these kids, because I had been teaching with Heritage. And he saw something, and God saw something. God used his eyes to see something that I didn't see, and that was that I could do this, be with these kids and encourage them and be encouraged by them. And it caused me to grow and trust him in like these new unique ways. And one of my favorite things is you, young people, every one of you, from like the littlest one, Calvin, all the way up to the oldest one, I think in like eighth and ninth grade. And just how your hearts are so excited for God and alive for God and growing. One of my favorite things when I first came here was how the children just were excited for the word and just knew the word and were just hungry for the word and for Jesus and for growing. And it's just been a blessing. And this week, for our last week, the theme is on growing in God and taking brave steps, and we've been going through the life of Jesus, and today we're at the part in the scriptures, because we've been reading along together, where John the Baptist is revealed, and he reveals Jesus when he comes to the water to be baptized. And so that took me back to the very beginning, because his birth was foretold, and God says that every birth matters to him, whether you're foretold by an angel or not. Some of you know that in the history of our world, this is not only Sanctity of Human Life Weekend, but it's also Holocaust Remembrance Weekend. And when you think about the journey of lives of young people, that whether you could be someone who has a very short life or a very long life, but your life matters. And I want to convey that to you through the story of John the Baptist, that from the very beginning, God had a thought about him, even before he was a seed. I was hearing that from a pastor even this morning. Before he was a seed, he was a thought in God's heart. And have you ever thought about that? Has anyone ever said to you, like your grandparents ever said, you were a twinkle in your mom's eye or your dad's eye, you know, and God loved you then. And so I just want to encourage you that your story is being written before your seed. There's Calvin, he's even paying attention. And when you're growing and as you're becoming, and I just remember when we were going over the story, if you remember that when John was a little baby and he was inside his mom and his cousin, Jesus, was inside Mary. Do you guys remember what John did inside his mom when they met? Does anyone remember? Yeah, the baby jumped. The baby moved. The baby moved with joy, and we talked about joy last week. And so from, you know, can you imagine these cousins? I have cousins. You guys have had me pray for your cousins that have grown up together and believed in each other and encouraged each other, had fun together, played together, fought together. But when it was time, when they had grown up now to where God's call was on both of their lives, John yielded to who Jesus was. Even though he was conceived first, and he was born first, and, you know, maybe, you know, he wasn't born, you know, out of wedlock or before his parents were married, anything type of scandal may not have been on his life, but he literally loved his cousin. And that's what I love about this story. Jesus comes to us as a baby with all these things, no money. The mom is a single mom, but the husband embraces her. So many things that they had to go through. We talked about him having to escape. He was a refugee. All these things. But God loved him, and God used their story. And then the last part I want to share is, you know, when John said, you know, I must decrease, Jesus, because you're going to increase. And when he baptized Jesus, when Jesus went down, the Holy Spirit came and descended on him and just said, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. And I just want to share that with you children and with you as our congregation. The Lord looks on you with beloved love. Obviously, you're not his only begotten son, but in the same way, the reason Jesus was sent is to tell you, I have loved you with an everlasting love, and I have drawn you with the cords of kindness. So I just want to encourage you that you will always remember you have a purpose, whether it was a hard way for you to get here this morning, like for me, or it was an easy way, whether it you've been through a long journey or hard journey, whether you've had only to eat, you know, a little bit of food like John did, locusts, whether you've been through a desert or a wilderness, or you're going through a great time right now. God loves you with the everlasting love. He draws you with cords of kindness. And Jesus, your Savior, your Shepherd, your King, is walking with you. So I just want to thank you all for the beauty of getting to share Christ with you in this way with the children. And I want to take time to pray right now. Dear Lord, I just thank you so much for these amazing children and for this congregation. I thank you that you have a purpose for every life. You know, I was thinking, I was reading different stories recently and reading about Anne Frank, for instance, and I was, Lord, why would you let a child go through so much pain and suffering? But yet her story echoes to our generation, encourages us. Your life matters. You can encourage just one person. And you have a purpose for every soul. So I pray for these children as they continue to grow and take brave journeys, that they will trust you, that you will use them to bless others, that they will jump for joy as they get to share you with others, whether it be at school or at home or when they're out in the community or just, you know, helping around the house. I pray that you'll bless this church with many great things to come, that they won't worry, that they won't fret, that they know that the God, the creator of the universe, is taking care of them. We bless you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Before you go, we wanted to pray for you as you're going for a safe trip, a safe journey, and a safe, a good transition to Oregon. So let me lead us in prayer real quick as we can bless Cindy. Lord, we ask your blessing on Cindy and Ken as they go, that their trip would be safe, that the community would embrace them and they would find new friends and new places to worship you as they care for Ken's dad. We ask your blessing on him and everything that happens in this transition, Lord. We are so grateful for Cindy and the blessing she has been to us and ask that you would bless her for the good work she's done here. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. If I could say one more thing, and that is that kids are pretty awesome. That's probably not news to you, but when you see kids running around and being kids, allow them to be kids, because if they're probably not all going to remember every story that we tell them every Sunday, but they are going to remember how this church made them feel, all right? And that's the main thing. So don't forget to be kind. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. All right.
Testing. Hi. Okay. Well, thanks. I'm Brian Silker. Welcome to Union Church this morning. That story reminded me of how to treat children. It was my birthday yesterday, so we had a family party, and my sister was there. We were talking about our step-grandfather, Owen, and my sister said, not a very nice guy. And my brother said, oh, he was a great guy. So turns out Claudia got spanked by Owen when she was about 5 years old. Wow. And from that point on, she had wanted nothing to do with Grandpa Owen. Wow. So, you know, she probably did something wrong. She admits it, but that was it. Being spanked when you're a five-year-old by your grandpa, don't ever do that. And I think that's one of the things they say about being a grandparent is you don't have to discipline your grandchildren. Let the parents do that. But anyway, that's a good point, Dave. So anyway, I was just looking in the pews, and we want everybody to feel welcome and fill out a connection card, but I, at least over here, I didn't see any connection cards in the pew. Okay, Andrea has one. If you need a connection card or would like to fill one out, maybe some of the people who have them can raise them up and you can get one. Because we would like to connect with you with these connection cards, and next Sunday we'll make sure there are more of them in the pews. But this is a way that you can find out about the various ministries in our church, and you could submit prayer requests on these cards or request to be added to the weekly email. And fortunately, you can also go online and connect with us there at unionpc.org. So those are the different ways to connect. So save the date for our annual congregational meeting, which will be on Sunday, February 11th, following the worship service over in Bailey Hall. And the purpose of this meeting will be to receive the 2023 annual report and review the 2024 budget and outlook for the year, and to vote on the pastoral terms of call. So we will not be mailing out the annual report ahead of time, but there will be a link, I guess that is on the website, a link to download a copy will be included in the, oh, it says in the weekly email, sent out a few days before the meeting. So you'll be able to review the annual report at that time. Everyone's invited to celebrate the beginning of Lent with our Ash Wednesday worship service in the sanctuary at 10 a.m. Wednesday, February 14th, Valentine's Day. This meaningful service will be in person only, includes communion and the imposition of ashes. If you're unable to attend at that time, there will be Stations of the Cross available from 8 a.m. to 6:30 p.m. And the Lenten stations are a go-at-your-own-pace time of reflection in preparation for Easter. Have you been thinking about becoming a member here at Union Church? We're holding a Membership 101 class in the near future. At this class, you'll learn Union's mission and vision, what we believe, our commitment to missions, both local and worldwide, and expectations and more. If you're interested in attending this class, or if you're interested in being baptized, please contact Pastor Dave. We also are sad to share that longtime Union member and friend Margaret Miller has been called home to be with our Lord. She passed away earlier this week on January 23rd, 2024, and we'll let you know details of a memorial service as they become available. So why don't we bow our heads now for a moment of silence. Amen. Now we have our monthly Bible verse, which is Psalm 31:24. If we could repeat that together. Be strong and take heart, all you who hope in the Lord. As part of our worship, we continue to give back to God out of the blessings he's given us. During the offering music, we invite the ushers to come forward to pass the plate to collect the offering. Other ways to give include mailing a check to the church, or you can give online at unionpc.org/give.
Lord, we are grateful for the ability to give out of the abundance that you've blessed us with. But more than that, Lord, we are so grateful that we can come to you always in prayer, no matter what's going on in our lives, no matter the loss that we have suffered. And we do pray for Margaret's family, her extended clan, Lord, that love her and miss her already, and especially Bob, Lord, we lift up him and pray for him that he would be feeling your presence even in the midst of his grief. And we pray, Lord, for Lauren as he recovers from surgery. We pray for the many people in our church who are struggling with long-term illnesses. I think of Cliff and Christy and many others. Lord, we ask your blessing on them as well. We are grateful, Lord, that you are a God who hears our prayers, who knows us intimately and loves us no matter what. We are grateful, Lord. Help us to live in gratitude. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. So the Old Testament reading is Psalm 76, verses 1 to 12. God is renowned in Judah. In Israel, his name is great. His tent is in Salem, his dwelling place in Zion. Then he broke the flashing arrows, the shields and the swords, the weapons of war. You are radiant with light, more majestic than the mountains, rich with game. The valiant lie plundered. They sleep their last sleep. Not one of the warriors can lift his hands. At your rebuke, God of Jacob, both horse and chariot lie still. It is you alone who are to be feared. Who can stand before you when you are angry? From heaven you pronounced judgment, and the land feared and was quiet. When you, God, rose up to judge, to save all the afflicted of the land. Surely your wrath against mankind brings you praise, and the survivors of your wrath are restrained. Make vows to the Lord your God and fulfill them. Let the neighboring lands bring gifts to the one to be feared. He breaks the spirit of the rulers. He is feared by the kings of the earth. Okay, so I have to tell you, this is a thinking cap sermon. And so if you need to, you know, mentally put on a thinking cap, now's the time to do that. You guys know that I love sports, all kinds and shapes. I think in America, we love team sports. We love the all guys coming, or women too, coming together to accomplish a goal. But every 4 years, we got kind of interested in individual sports at the Olympics. In Estonia, they love the Olympics. They love individual sports. Kaidi's brother, I think I've mentioned this, but he was a biathlonist, which is where you ski around and then shoot things. And I think he could have been an Olympic caliber athlete had he had better skis and better guns when he was younger, but they kind of are from the middle of nowhere and they didn't have much money, and so he kind of trains their Olympic teams now. It's funny how close in the Olympics, especially on the shorter races, how close people can be, the difference between winning and losing. For instance, in the last Olympics, I don't know if you know this or if you remember this, Americans finished 1, 2, and 3 in the 100-yard meters, right? Fred Kersley ran a 9.86. Marvin Bracy ran a 9.8874. And Trayvon Bromell ran a 9.8876. So 2/1000ths of a second. The slowest guy in the final ran a 10.07. So about 2/10ths of a second behind the guy that won everything. I mean, so it's just so close. And I have to tell you, Christianity is not like that at all. There are not degrees in Christianity where you're getting close, where you're working on having a better life. And so sometimes you win and you're a better Christian, and sometimes you're not quite as good and you lose out and you're not a Christian. It isn't like that in Christianity. I mean, Christianity is about someone who is dead, who is now alive in Christ. So let's get into it. This is Ephesians chapter 2. Paul writes, "But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions." It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves. It's the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Let me pray for us. Lord, this is your word to them then, to us now. And I ask that you would help us understand it and make it come alive and we could live into it. We pray these things always in Jesus' name. Amen. So part of what I want you to hear today, the big part of it, is that being a Christian is not a matter of degree or thousandths of a degree. What a bummer to lose by 2/1000ths of a degree. But it's the difference between life and death. And I know sometimes people explain Christianity by saying, oh, I'm trying to live like Jesus did. He's my example. And that sounds good. And I do want Jesus to be my example and how I love other people and how I forgive other people and how I'm full of grace. But Jesus is more than human also. So he was going to be able to do things that you and I will never be able to do. Walk on water, make food come from nowhere, or live a sinless life. If you think that Jesus living a sinful life is something that you can aspire to, I don't even want to say good luck, because I don't even want you trying. It's just not possible. Because if he was our example of how to live a perfect life, we are all blowing it. Jesus came instead to give us new life and to give it to us abundantly. Christianity is the difference between life and death, not degrees in a race. And if that's true, then I don't think Christianity is something you can either fall into or fall out of just carelessly. Jesus says we have to be born again. And the wording here indicates something new has happened, a new person, rather than an old person trying to work out a few kinks. We're trying to work out my anger. I've got these anger issues. I'm hoping that Christianity will work on them. That's not it. It's that God wants to give you a whole new you, not just some paint and polish slapped on the old person. That doesn't seem to be what Christ is talking about. Now, when this new person comes about through a union with Christ, this is important for Paul. He says we're to be united with Christ. There are three verbs here in verses 4 and 5, that we are made alive and that we are raised up and we are seated with God. And you and I are the objects of all those verbs. This is what happens to us. And further, and I apologize if I've put you to sleep already, each verb has a prefix of S-Y-N, which means together with. Together, we're doing this. So an example in English would be synchronized swimming, right? Or synonymous, words that are together, mean the same thing. So all strong words, all with this prefix, that means together. So we are raised together with Christ, is what Paul says. We're seated together with Christ. In Galatians, a verse I've been banging on about for the last couple weeks, he says, I have been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. So we've been looking at that verse kind of tangentially over the last few weeks. And this is how Christians feel, or at least have felt, when you're in this deep time of gratitude. And there can be these weird moments when someone's new in Christ and we think, did I just do that nice thing? That doesn't seem like something I used to do, but yet here I am. Or, you know, did I just forego a profit because it wasn't ethical? That doesn't seem like something I would have done a year ago, but now, here I am. Being a Christian can actually be complicated psychologically. It doesn't get rid of your problems. In fact, it might even create some issues. But our sinful nature pushes us always for control, to be in complete control of our lives, to be God over ourselves. But when someone says yes to Christ, that desire for control has to die. Now, it can be an immediate death, and that would be really nice at least for me, that would have been awesome. But I think that's less common. It really, at least in my life, my dying to self has been the death of an overactor. You know, he's stumbling around, wiping things off the desk and throwing over chairs. It's very dramatic as the self dies. But while our sinful nature is dying, the Holy Spirit is actually cultivating a new nature. And that's what makes it complicated. Paul says, I am Saul of Tarsus, and I'm not. He's both, right? The change is that he's been crucified with Christ. And what happens in a crucifixion is, of course, that someone dies. Your old self dies. When we become follower of Jesus, we enter this new relationship with Christ. No longer is he just a teacher that we admire or a guy that said challenging things while really blessing people, but we were crucified with him and then seated with him. And you might have picked up that these verses, rather these verbs, are all in the past tense. And it would totally make sense to understand, to say, you know, I will be seated with Christ. I will be raised up with him. But that isn't what the text says. Instead, it says God has raised us up. He has seated us already there with Christ. And what I understand this to mean is that we have a personal relationship with Christ, but the ultimate cause of that comes from outside of us. That what is happening is that we are coming into, and I'll try and explain this, a federal relationship with Jesus, that he is our federal leader. He's our representative, like we have in Congress. We have a legal, covenantal relationship with Christ. And so I get that that's complicated. Let me take a few minutes to try and bring some clarity. And if I haven't done that at the end, come find me and I'll try and say it a different way. In Romans 5, it says, as sin entered the world through Adam and through the disobedience of one, many became sinners. Through the obedience of one, many will be made righteous. So this is in the past tense form. It's in a verb tense called the aorist in Greek. And the aorist is this weird, to us in our language, verb tense that it something happened in the act in the past, and it might be completed, but it also might be ongoing. It's ambiguous when it comes to that. So him being our federal head, that's both a completed action, but it's also an ongoing action. And I'll try and give you a couple examples. I think the second one's better, but I'll give you both. When people get married, there becomes this federal headship, that this new entity has been created, this legal entity of David and Heidi. That entity, if it goes well, blesses both of them. Perhaps we'll own a house someday and the debts of home ownership and its benefits will come to both of us. Or if both of us, that legal entity goes bad, then it'll be bad for both of us. Or if you hire an attorney for a legal matter, he or she is in a federal relationship with you. And so if they do well in trying to figure out your legal matter, they introduce all the right evidence and they make the right motions and they interview the right people and bring out the right truths, then you do well. But if they do kind of a haphazard, sloppy job and they forget about evidence and they don't cross-examine very well, then you're going to suffer. That's the law. You have entered into that sort of a federal headship relationship with them. So let's think about this theologically. On the cross, Jesus took on our sin. Jesus became sin. He wasn't actually a sinner, but he took on our sin as though it was his. That's the most selfless, the most loving, the most obedient act in history. And Jesus willingly does this, knowing that God is holy and will forsake him because of the sin that he has taken on. Jesus, let me say this again, was not actually a sinner, but he was legally in God's eyes. When he becomes our federal head, our sins came to him, and our punishment came to him. And in return, says in 2 Corinthians, for our sake, God made him be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sins so that we could be made right with God through Christ. Am I being clear? Jesus never sinned, but functioned as though he had, taking on our sin. And you and I are not righteous, but we function as though we are because Jesus gave us his righteousness. So you are not righteous in and of yourself, but you are legally righteous when you are in Christ. You and I still have lots of faults, anger, a bent towards selfishness, pride, greed, all that stuff. And yet in God's eyes, you are righteous. So when you choose to trust Jesus, he becomes your federal head, your representative. And all of his righteousness that he earned now counts as yours. We like to use the word imputed, which means put on. You have imputed righteousness, not your own, but a righteousness that is put on you. We there? Give me a little nod. Yeah, okay, good. So you can see a little of why Paul says, it is I, and yet it's not I. I'm crucified with Christ. I'm raised with Christ. I'm seated with Christ. Everything that happened to Jesus has legally happened to you and me. There are many people who think that Christianity is about asking God for forgiveness and being nice to folks. And that's certainly part of it. But here's a glimpse at this bigger picture, that God sees that you died as the punishment for your sins. In God's eyes, you have paid the price. You have paid off the debt that your sin incurred. You know, when someone gets caught speeding, the cop writes a ticket and you pay the fine, and then life goes on because you have paid the penalty for that action. In Christ, you have already paid off every sin that you will ever commit, every sin that you have committed. So if and when you get depressed by your sinful nature, remember again that you have paid the penalty for those crimes. All that is really necessary is to admit to God, to confess, and allow the Holy Spirit into your heart and into your life to further work on you. What I worry about always is that some of us are trying to atone for our sins and not living in the freedom and the joy Christ purchased for us. We're still trying to make things right between us and God. There's no need. That's been taken care of. It's been paid in full. It's one thing, of course, to have that in your head, right? It's another thing to have it in your heart. And what I want for us is to have that knowledge in our heads and in our hearts. I mean, think of Paul getting this, really. He'd been a head believer in God his whole life, and now in Christ, he becomes a head and a heart believer. You know, Galatians 2:15, he says, "We who are Jews by birth and not sinful Gentiles know that a person is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ." So we too have put our faith in Christ Jesus, that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. But because by the works of the law, no one will be justified, get right with God. But if in seeking to be justified in Christ, we Jews find ourselves among the sinners, doesn't that mean that Christ promotes sin? Absolutely not. If I rebuild what I destroyed, then I really would be a lawbreaker. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live for God. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. So either we are dead in our sins or gloriously alive in Christ. There's no middle ground. There's no fence to sit on. There's no knife edge out there that we can stand on where we could go either way. Either we owe God a debt that is impossible to pay, or we owe him nothing. It's already paid. Either we're in bondage to one sin or another, or we're free. And I've said this is what makes Christianity different from every other religion. Every other religion says, here's the way to atone for your sins, to the path to freedom, to gain higher consciousness. You do all these things. You head on this path. You make these sacrifices. That's it. And only Jesus says, none of that's necessary. I got you. I've paid for everything in full. There is now no condemnation in Christ Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. Or you could try and earn God's favor by doing things, making sacrifices, going on pilgrimages, depriving yourself of things. I have no idea. And that path offered often looks pretty good. You know, love your family, give to the poor, be a person of integrity, that sort of thing. And Jesus does want you to live like that, but not in order to earn God's love. You already have that, more than you can possibly imagine. You have his love, you have his grace. There is no path to God and his favor. There is Jesus, and he is the path. He is God's favor. He is our righteousness. He is everything needed for a life with God. Jesus is our federal head. And so when we receive him as Lord and Savior and stop trying to find a way to God because we are find out that we are in God automatically, and we're crucified, and we're raised, and we're seated, or not. Now, to be clear, people who receive Christ are not better people than average. I mean, I know that to be totally true, and I suspect you do as well. I mean, God loves us, but he doesn't love us more when we try really hard to be good or when we've suffered more than other people. God loves everybody, but the issue is still sin. If God loves people, but they're still carrying their sins themselves, God, who is holy, cannot, will not tolerate them in his presence. Only those whose sins have been taken care of, paid for, redeemed, those people will be with him in eternity. And I don't think that's evidence of a mean or vindictive God, but a God who is trying to reconcile his own holiness with the lack of holiness by his beloved creation. I mean, we are supremely tainted by sin, but God, because he is also love, created this pathway, this person, Jesus himself, who has done everything necessary for sinful humanity to reconcile with the holy God. All that needs to happen is that you have to ask for Jesus to come and rule over your life. That's it. There's no physical punishment to be ensured. There's no financial settlement necessary. There's no special confinement or deprivation. It's just that the Holy Spirit, when you say yes to God, moves into your life and begins making some changes, rooting out what I think we'd all agree is bad. I mean, anger issues, self-esteem issues, pride, greed, jealousy. I don't know anybody that thinks that that stuff is good. And in that, we agree with God. It isn't good for people to be like that. So because of God's great love, you have been crucified and raised and seated. You are complete in Christ. And if you feel bad about something you've done, apologize to God and get on with life because you've been crucified already. If you're doing something that you know you ought not to do, stop doing that thing. Apologize to God and be open to the reshaping of your heart and your life because the Holy Spirit is now on the job. But only if you want the Holy Spirit. God doesn't just barge in and take over. He waits to be invited. So have a short memory about your failings and the failings of others, because God does. One last thing. There have been some movements in the history of Christianity that have understood this freedom and this grace and this love, and they said, wow, if all that's true, then I can go ahead and do whatever I want to. And this is one of the issues that Paul deals with in the church in Corinth. And he actually addresses it in for the church in Corinth, but he spells it out in Romans 6:1. He says this, what shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? He says, by no means. How can we who died to sin live in it any longer? But I have to say, if you've never thought of this, that grace is so wonderful and God's love is so free, why should I not do everything I've ever wanted to do? Then maybe you've really never understood the grace, the depth of the grace and the freedom of the gospel. Because once somebody really hears and understands that grace and the love of God, that should be absolutely the first question that comes up. But if somebody really accepts Jesus into their heart and understood and felt on this deep level God's grace and his holiness, then someone would never want to offend this God that they love with what they do. A fear of retribution was never intended to be the reason for good works. Good works, good deeds, and we'll get into this in the next couple of weeks, come as a response to God's love. It's our love back to God rather than fear. John talks about this, 1 John 4:18. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. Fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not been perfected in love. I mean, the ultimate punishment or fear is separation from God. And thankfully, for those who believe in Christ, who are in Christ, that fear is past. Let's pray. Jesus, as we delve deeply into your word and understand again the depth of your grace and love, I am, hopefully we are, moved to confess the things that we know that we are still struggling with, that we are who we are, but we are raised and we are seated and we are crucified, and yet we still struggle. So, Lord, I ask that you would hear us confess the sins we struggle with and reassure us, Lord, that we have been crucified in you and that we no longer live, but you do. Lord, hear our confessions. God, we are grateful that you are a God of grace and love, and you sent Jesus to take on all the bad stuff that we have created. And so we lift up ourselves to you, that you would forgive us for the things that we have said and the things that we have done, even the things that we've thought and the things that we've left undone and the things that we've left unsaid. Lord, we are so grateful for who you are and your grace and forgiveness. And one way to remind us of that is to pray the Lord's Prayer. So why don't we do that together? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I tell you with the full authority of God that you are forgiven, and God's grace is for us. And that's good news. Amen.
I invite us to stand. Our closing song is Draw Me Close.
Oh,
you send us out with a benediction. Lord, send us out from this place full again of the head knowledge and the heart knowledge of your grace and love that is deeper than any sin that we could ever commit, anything that we could ever think of. Your love and your grace, Lord, can cover that. If there's anyone here who needs, Lord, to come to you, to say yes, finally, Lord, prompt them in their hearts to start this fantastic journey. Lord, send us, all of us out of here in the knowledge of your love and grace, the presence of the Holy Spirit, the love of Christ, and the power of God Almighty be on us as we go into our areas of ministry. And the people of God say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.